So thank you so much for all to come today, despite the streets are not yet as they should be. And for me, it was very tough this morning to arrive at 8 a.m. at federal government, despite it was closed, but they were working at 8 a.m. So let me, the idea of today is to give you a quick presentation on what the hunger index is doing for 2015. But one of the important things, I think, is the topic, which in this case perfectly hit in an environment in a time where the topic is extremely important. And it raises issues that come back to history. So what I wanted to show you is some quotes of a very nice article that was published in the New York Times called The Next Genocide by Timothy Snyder. Look at what he's bringing up. He's an economic historian, and the war that brought Jews under German control was fought because Hitler believed that Germany needed more land and food to survive and maintain its standing of living. So Hitler had the idea that technological change and improvement in agriculture wouldn't be enough to be able to create enough food for the people to be able to subsist well, and therefore that was one of the reasons of his decision to go into significant conflict. Similar, the mass murder of at least 500,000 Rwandans in 1994 followed a decline in agricultural production for several years before, and Hutus killed Tutsi not only out of ethnic hatred, but also take their land, as many genocides later admitted. So there are many cases like the one in Sudan, in the next quote, which bring this problem of conflict. We heard a lot about unrest during the 2007-2008 crisis in terms of food, but this comes back from history, and whenever you have a war and a conflict like we are facing today, you end in migration, you end in a lot of the areas where agriculture is being grown to be destroyed, and therefore into issues of food security, and that of course affects hunger, malnutrition, and stunting, which is the topic behind the Global Hunger Index. Now, why is important to have this index, and why IFPRI and our collaborators keep working on having this joint effort across years? First, because we believe it raises awareness. We are conscious that the data not necessarily is the best data that we should have in hands to do this, but we want to raise awareness to be able to improve on that. And one of the issues that this report raises is the importance of missing data and how we can resolve that. It shows progress over time, which is extremely important, to see how things are performing and where we see that things are not performing so that we can take action over those. It highlights successes and failures. It provides incentives to act. And of course, it focuses on one major hunger-related topic every year, which in this case is the case of conflict. Now, the Hunger Index tries to improve across years. And in this year, there is an improvement in terms of the methodology. Basically, we are looking at four indicators: undernourishment, which is inadequate amount of food for both adults and children; child wasting, children under age whose weight is low for their height; child stunting, children under age of 5 whose height is low for their age; and child mortality, death of children under the age of 5. And these are combined in a very simple way. So please don't ask me any question about the weighting, because the idea of the weighting is to make it very simple and not to complicate us too much. I understand and I know all the potential questions behind how to define the weightings and how we can do it in the best possible way. But the concept of the hunger index is to have a very simple measure, but especially the benefit is that we use the same measure across time so that we can compare over time. So basically, there are three groups of elements. It's 1/3 each. So child wasting and child stunting is divided into 1/6, 1/6 each. And then undernourishment is 1/3, and child mortality is 1/3. And we basically aggregate, and based on that, we create the index that is being presented. The GHI is calculated for 117 countries. It's also a reflection of data from 2010 and 2016 period, and that's something that we need to highlight substantially, the lack of the best possible data to be able to develop the most up-to-date information for this type of indices. What we will have, for example, is real-time data, no? But as you know, that's a dream, but I hope at some point it will become a reality. So it reflects data sometimes from 2010 to 14, and for the proportion of undernourished projections is from 2014 to 16. As I mentioned before, it combines three dimensions: inadequate food supply, child undernutrition, and child mortality. Then we aggregate the indicators, and with that we create the GHI scores, which basically, if the GHI goes up, means that the situation is worsening, and if it decreases, it means that the situation is an improvement. This is just to give you a graphical idea of what we mean by the different types of childhood malnutrition. So you have the normal, which is basically the normal height for the age, waisted when it's low weight for height, stunted, low height for age, and underweight when you have low weight for age. And if you want to put a picture of reality, we have Guatemala here. This is the case of Guatemala, and the blue line is where they should be at the age of 9 years old, and you will see how different they are. And this is basically from the western part of Guatemala, which have a huge problem of undernutrition and hunger. Now, what is the progress and what we have found in this GHI of 2015? When we look at the progress on stunting reduction, if we look at the countries which are on the process, on the improvement level that we want, what we call on course, we move from 24 in 2014 to 39 in 2015. Of course, from 66, it went down to 60. And of course, with no progress, it's 19 down to 15. So in stunting, we have a progress, but again, we still have big numbers, as it was mentioned before. When we look at the progress on wasting reduction, it has, on course, 59 countries. It moved up to 67 in 2015. It moved down from 64, of course, countries to 63 in 2015. So a small reduction in that period of time. The severity of the GHI, the index goes from 0 to 100. Of course, 0 and 100 normally is not reachable, but mostly we are concerned with situations which we call serious, which goes from 20 to 34.9, to alarming, 35 to 44.9, and to extremely alarming, which in this year we don't have any country of which we have data that is in that range. If we look at the number of countries that fall in those ranges, in low we have 42 countries, in moderate, we have 23 countries, in serious, 44 countries, and in alarming, 8 countries. So still, serious and alarming is an extremely high number of countries of the ones we have data available, as I will show in a few minutes. This is the hunger index. You all have the publication, and these are the results. What is astonishing is if you look to South America, and you look to Europe and Eastern Europe, you see a lot of greens, no? Which means that the hunger index is very low, as I mentioned in the scale before. But when you look into Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, the situation is very different. And those countries which are on gray are countries for which we don't have data. So not only for the countries that we have data, there is some delay in the availability of the data, but there are countries, especially the ones that could be in the worst situations, most of them are landlocked, where we don't have data available to be able to construct this index. Now, if we look at the changes over time, what is important to see is how, for example, at a world level, consistent to what we also observe on poverty reduction, there has been a substantial improvement in the reduction of the hunger index. But despite that, if you look at sub-Saharan Africa and you look at South Asia, the numbers are still extremely high. And that's the problem. The trend is going down, which is improvement, but still we have pretty important high numbers, both in South Asia and sub-Saharan Africa, that we need to look and try to find solutions to resolve those levels of problems. Now, within the regions, there is a lot of variance too, and a lot of inequality, which we need to be careful when assess each of the countries. Even if you look to Latin America, which has a very low level of hunger index, again, within Central America, we have huge variance, not only at the country level, but also within the countries, which is something that really caught your attention. And also, you have countries in southern part of Africa, like Zambia, a very rich country, for example, that has one of the worst indicators on the hunger index. So that there is a lot of inconsistencies from where we can learn a lot and from where we can try to do changes to improve the situation so that we can achieve what we are looking for in the SDGs. This is basically showing the country progress in reducing the GHI scores. So it's the percentile change in 2015 GHI compared with the 2000 GHI. And the greener, the better it is. So for example, the green colors are the ones who decrease by 50% or more, and clearly Brazil, Peru, Venezuela, which is a strange case because it's a country with a lot of strange policies in place, but a lot of the policies are subsidies towards food and so on and so forth, which had allowed them to improve substantially. It will be important to see how it will face, how it will show up in the next year. But again, Venezuela clearly is a country where we have a problem of data, and we will need to look at that data carefully to see what is going on. But again, you see that in the cases of Africa and sub-Saharan Africa, we still don't have the level of decreases that we would like to have to show the progress we need, because in absolute levels, it still is too high. This is basically plotting the countries, and just to bring some examples of the countries which are doing the best. In the vertical axis, you have the percent of reduction of the GHI since 2000, And in the horizontal, you have the level of the hunger in 2015, hunger index. So Ethiopia, Angola, and Rwanda are three countries that show a significant change with respect to 2000. But again, remember, the levels are extremely high. So they are in the right-hand side of the graph, saying that the hunger index still in absolute levels is high, despite the change is substantial and there is an improvement. The important thing and the beauty, I think, of the hunger index is the time series that they are building, which will allow to see if that trend continues over time or if changes. So some of the key findings. The first one is that in 2015, developing world GHI fell by 27% relative to 2000 score from 29.9 to 21.7 points. Africa, south of the Sahara, as I mentioned, and South Asia have the highest levels of hunger with regional scores of 32.2 and 29.4. From 2000 to 2015, 17 countries reduced their scores by 50% or more. And that's the countries from where we can learn and try to validate what the data is telling us. In terms of absolute progress between 2000 and 2015, Rwanda, Angola, and Ethiopia saw the biggest change, as I mentioned before when I was showing you this graph and the big change that those three countries have. This is basically showing the changes in Rwanda, Angola, and Ethiopia, but again, their hunger levels are still extremely high, and that's something that we need to look at it carefully and trying to see how sustainable those policies will be and how much that velocity of improvement will continue over time. The countries with the highest 2015 GHI scores are the highest, which are at the highest levels of hunger, were Central Africa Republic, Chad, and Zambia. People of the Central Africa Republic and Chad have faced violent conflict, which is related to what we were mentioning at the beginning, how conflict could affect. We are not talking of causality, we are talking of association and correlation. But clearly, the conflict affects the level of hunger, and that's something that we need to look at. But it can also go in the other side, as we saw in some cases in the 2007 and 2008 crisis. But there is a section of Zambia, which is a country that we have been working a lot, and we are looking at it very closely. And it's a country that has levels of undernourishment and malnutrition, which is enormous. And there is not too much of a sense on what is happening in that country. If you go to a country and you see what is there and the amount of foreign investment and what is happening in terms of agriculture, the numbers that you're observing in terms of malnutrition and the hunger index, and the same we found in the nutrition report, the same type of indicators, is something that is really unacceptable. Similar in Latin America to the case of Guatemala. You have a country which is extremely rich in terms of resources, has the biggest sugar plantations in the world, I think one of the biggest, a lot of natural resources, a huge private sector, and you have enormous levels of undernutrition in the west side of Honduras, of Guatemala, and now also in the case of Honduras and El Salvador. So there are things that we need to look closely to be able to assess what is happening there. So that's why here we circle Zambia, because it's something there which the story, we cannot tell the story carefully. And I think it could be a future topic to look at governance issues and how governments and how much policy failure we have in those countries, that because of that we are facing this type of situation, which is similar to the case of Central African Republic and Chad, where conflict is more clear. So when we were looking at the conflict, we tried to trace the countries which were doing not so good in terms of the hunger levels and track what type of conflicts were there in Central African Republic, by series of armed conflicts since 2001 to 2014, in Chad, the civil war in 2005-2010, in Timor the Leste, occupation of Indonesia, and ongoing violence in Sierra Leone, Haiti. In all these countries, there is enormous amount of conflict which could be explaining what is happening behind. Now, one of the issues that are important is the lack of data. Not only the lack of current data to be able to update these indicators as fast as we can, with the simplicity that they have, which is done in purpose, but also the lack of data for the countries which are in bigger conflict. And we need to find ways, and technology today could allow us to do that, ways in we can resolve that gap. It could be that the data won't be perfect, but at least it will be an early warning system for humanitarian agencies to be able to do a better job in those countries and for us to trace what is going on and how things can be improved. Now, in these countries that we have lack of data, of course, there are several issues that we need to resolve, and there are issues that we need to keep improving to be able to keep going with this hunger index. So let me just finish with 3 points. First, there is a tremendous progress that has been made towards eliminating global hunger. This is consistent to the numbers that we have been seeing on poverty from the World Bank, the numbers from FAO, the new adjusted numbers from FAO. And basically, this improvement is shown also in the GHI. But still, in absolute numbers, we have a problem. There are countries that have progressed enormously. Brazil is one of those cases in the case of Latin America. But there are countries also where what we are observing is not consistent to what it should be in reality. Conflicts are strongly associated with severe hunger, and that's something to look at. This is not only historically, but also today. And climate change and what is happening today in terms of weather could also be a problem, and that's something to look at very carefully. Like today, for example, we are facing the problem of El Nino, and that's creating a serious situation in Southern Africa and in some Central American countries, and also in other parts of Africa, in Ethiopia, for example. So we need to think on ways in which we can try to minimize that risk of conflict, which is something that could happen, especially in resources like water, which will be very scarce in the future, and which today they are not being priced properly. And finally, reducing armed conflict and extreme poverty and addressing their consequences are key to ending hunger. And that's something that we need to work hard in trying to find ways to minimize that, and I think it's something the next speaker will go more in detail. Thank you so much.